Hello and welcome to our second Making Lean Fly podcast. The subject of this one is what is BTFA? And I'm your host, Philip Holt, and I'm going to introduce in a second our guest, Anthony Howarth, who was also on the first podcast. But we're also joined this time by Rob Everidge, one of our lean experts in the Lean Centre of Excellence in GK and Aerospace. So I'll get those two to introduce themselves in a moment. But basically, just to give you a little bit of a background to the reason for this subject in this podcast, many people are familiar with the PDCA, the Deming-Shewhart cycle, which describes the plan, do, check, act sequence required to make a change process effective. However, whilst it's a logical approach to change, it doesn't adequately explain or guide one through the psychology of change. So we've adopted the Bovis model, BTFA, which shows the interactive and iterative nature of change through its description of the human experience of believe, think, feel, and act. So I'm going to ask Anthony and Rob to share their experiences using this over the past 2 years and how it's really augmented and complemented the PDCA cycle and the way that we've been deploying our lean operating model. So welcome on the show again, Anthony.
Thank you, Philip.
And welcome to you, Rob. Your first time on the show. I'm sure it won't be the last.
No, thank you for welcoming me on.
Great. Okay. So what we're going to do before we get going into the actual BTFA subject is just want to get to know you a little bit. We already did it with Anthony last time. So people who've listened to the first podcast know quite a bit about Anthony now. Although one thing I was contemplating before is we didn't really talk about a lot of your experiences traveling. You've been to, you have to remind us in a second how many countries you've visited, Anthony, both on work and pleasure. And one of the ones that always interested me when we worked together in Phillips, you used to go down to really the southern tip of Argentina to Tierra del Fuego. So I thought it might be interesting for you just to share a little bit of your experiences deploying lean really at one of the most southernly cities in the world.
Yeah, look forward to that.
Excellent. So, but before you jump into that, let's talk with Rob a little bit about your interests. So, Rob, why don't you tell us a little bit about you know, what makes you tick? What are your personal interests?
What makes me tick? That's a good question. Adrenaline makes me tick. Aspects that really interest me in my life are things that push me to the limits. I like to push my personal limits of learning, speed, heights. I've done a lot of things in my personal life of stunt flights, motor racing, wing walks. I try to push my boundaries in life. I like to explore. You know, Anthony's done a lot of traveling and in his life. I love to travel. I love to go different places, try to go places where other people haven't been, which is very difficult, obviously. But Formula One is my ultimate passion, though. If I can watch that, if I can be at races, I'm a very happy person.
Excellent. And I'm sure you wouldn't expect anything else from me but to mention that you've got your martial arts interest, haven't you? So could you share a little bit about the martial arts, Rob?
Yeah, so I grew up most of my life playing ice hockey, and I got to a certain age where, you know, being part of a team, you know, we'd won the English Championship, and I sort of got to a limit where I think I'd achieved everything I needed to or wanted to in that sport, but I still needed something in my life. So I started Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. I've always been quite a shy person through my life. It doesn't compute quite well because I'm quite a talker, but I am quite a shy person. And so starting that was very, very difficult for me. And I had to overcome a lot of personal boundaries to actually sort of start to fight technically. But I actually grew to love it. The technical aspect of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu was incredible to learn. The dedication, the discipline that needs to go with that. But also for anybody listening, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is almost like a gentleman sport. If you're at any moment you don't want to be there, you can tap and sort of resign. And it's, there's no pride. It's fantastic sport to get into. I got quite successful. I was English champion. I got fourth in the Europeans. Unfortunately, over the last sort of year, my life has sort of changed and I do a bit too much traveling. But in hindsight, I've been using that as an excuse. There's plenty of schools around me. There's plenty of gyms around me. So I am starting to get back into it. So very exciting over the next couple of years. I want to get back into it and maybe represent GKN Aerospace around the globe somewhere.
That's excellent. And I think there's a lot of BTFA as we get into that subject now. It'll become clear that the description you just gave of how you moved from hockey into Brazilian jiu-jitsu includes a lot of the BTFA elements of change that we're going to talk about.
Absolutely.
And you know, of course, I can't end this sequence without talking about the fact that when you went to the US, to California, you, of course, got your butt kicked, so to speak, by Eric Chan, one of our former colleagues. And I'm sure Eric will be listening to this because I still contact him on LinkedIn, and I'm sure that he'll enjoy remembering how he shows you really how to do Brazilian jiu-jitsu.
Yeah, I haven't forgotten. I haven't forgotten.
Brilliant. All right, so listen, let's move on to the subject itself. So, Anthony, what's BTFA mean to you?
Yeah, so I guess I can start off by saying that, you know, I've been involved in a lot of change initiatives. I've been involved in deploying Lean for a number of years using various different operating systems and operating models. And, you know, quite often we face challenges in the deployment. You know, we face resistance. We're not getting the progress that we need, or we're not getting the results that we need. So over the years, I've been involved in quite a lot of problem solving around why we're not being as successful as we want to be with the lean operating model deployment. So, you know, I can probably remember, you know, 10 to 15 problem solving A3s that I've done, particularly around deployment progress. And what's interesting is when you get into the root causes, it's never related to the tools. It's never related to the system. You know, if we're never making progress, or if we've got problems with making progress, it's usually down to some human factor. And it's usually down to something related to believe, think, feel, or act. So even though I'd heard of BTFA, heard of it for probably the last, you know, 3 or 4 years at least, it really helped me to codify the things that you need to have, the critical success factors from a human perspective, to be successful, you know, in a deployment, you know, and particularly around, you know, do we share the same vision, the same aspirations? Do we feel, you know, the same kind of pain or problems? Because, you know, when you get down into it, it's usually because we've got some kind of misalignment between, you know, the pain of the organization or the pain that the site steering committee are feeling, and what it is that we're trying to influence or impact from a lean center of excellence perspective. And it's really only when those things are aligned can we be successful. So, if I look at BTFA and I look at the problem solving that I've done in the past, the root cause is nearly always related to BTFA and the human factors of a lean transformation.
Thanks, Anthony. That's very interesting. So I'm just thinking about this though, because again, you know, I'm an engineer. To me, it seems really simple. We want to make a change, and maybe I can address this question to you, Rob. So, you know, you're with one of your site teams, you decide that you need to make a change, you need to put in, I don't know, a pull system into part of the value stream, and you just do it, don't you? You just plan it out, you do it, you check the results, and you act accordingly. I mean, why do we need to then start talking about BTFA, believe, think, feel, and act? You know, why don't we just, you know, PDCA the heck out of this?
Yeah, it's an interesting discussion point, because, you know, you talk about you're an engineer and you've come up with an improvement. You're one person. You know, when we come up with change initiatives and transformations, or even simple Kaizen that we put in place, it's not just affecting one person. It affects a larger group of people. And that larger group of people, or maybe of using that process, they've been using that system. They've been working on that way of working for the last 5-10 years. So changing it is huge. And as people, as humans, we need to have the inputs. And I always go back to a discussion that I've been sort of talking about for quite a while is, you know, the average 4 to 5 year old child, they ask 300 to 400 questions a day. They need to gather input to ultimately gather the why. You know, why should I do this? Why am I going to bed? Why am I having to get in this car? Why do I need that for dinner? And the interesting thing is that as we start to get older, that gets knocked out of us, out of questions coming back to us saying, oh, you ask too many questions. Pride comes in, social awkwardness comes in. But as adults, we still need that why. Why should I do this? Why should I implement this change? Why do you want me to change? And it's really, really important for us as leaders, or as us as stakeholders that are driving change, is to understand that we need to provide that why. We still need to provide that input to people, even though they won't ask. So we need to provide that visioning, that belief that Anthony was talking about, so that we can give the why this change is important. What is in it for them? What will they get from it? So the summary of that is it's all about stakeholder management. BTFA is about getting that emotional handshake, that psychological connection between the person who's got this vision, this idea of change, who wants to make a change, and then for the group of people that are affected by that change to buy into it and sort of ultimately effectively sustain that change afterwards.
Brilliant. Thank you, Rob. I really like the way you explained that and described it. That's pretty good. So I guess, you know, what we've got here are perhaps some misconceptions about how you make change, because PDCA seems very, very logical. I think a lot of us are familiar with change models, particularly Cotter's change model. So again, I guess, Anthony, if we've got Cotter's change model, which we can use as well, you know, why would we need this Bovis model, this BTFA model?
I do see them, you know, completely aligned. You know, when I look at the 8 Cotter's principles of change management and what's in BTFA, I think the answer, Philip, is probably we're perhaps taking too much of a PDCA approach to addressing Cotter's 8 change management principles, and perhaps not getting enough into the hearts and the minds and the understanding of the people that are going to be involved and impacted by the change. You know, so for example, you know, one of Cotter's steps is to have a vision and to make sure that vision is well communicated. However, the vision needs to be something that people in the organization buy into and aspire to. You know, so if that vision isn't something that people can buy into and commit to, yeah, we might have checked it off in terms of one of the 8 Cotter principles of change management, but it's not really pulling at the heartstrings of the people that are going to be impacted, and maybe they're actually in conflict with what's being proposed in the vision. Maybe they don't agree with the vision. So I really think that if we're deploying the 8 Cotter change management principles, we've got to have BTFA built into those as well.
Yeah. And do you think, and I just want to stay with you a little bit, Anthony, I mentioned earlier kind of your trips to Iterative Wego and the work you did there a few years ago. And I guess that was quite a different culture, even within Argentina. I guess the culture down there was different than if you'd gone to Buenos Aires. So, you know, from a cultural perspective, you know, I guess you weren't explicitly using the BTFA model there, but is there things you can think back to that time and how you interacted and what impact that Bovis cycle was having compared to the PDCA cycle in the work that you did there?
Yeah, I have to say, you know, for those people that might be listening that have had the opportunity to work in many different cultures, For me, the Latin American culture, and particularly the Argentinian and Southern Argentinian culture, was a fantastic and sometimes frustrating culture to work within. Just to give you an example, within our lean operating model, we're quite structured in terms of our approach to Kaizen events, making sure that, the problem's well understood, well defined. We've got a problem solving A3. The event is chartered. We've got 4 weeks of preparation. We've certainly got an agenda and tools. We've got people organized. We've got rooms, venues, equipment organized. We might have even built production ahead of schedule so that we can take a line down. Very kind of, structured and rigid in our approach to avoid, problems that we might have faced in the past. Now, when I was working in Southern Argentina, even trying to agree an agenda, agreeing problems to solve was really, really difficult. And I hate to say it, but I remember flying out to Argentina without even really having a defined agenda for the activity that we were running that week. And if I'd have been working in Western Europe, we would have probably pulled the and on weeks earlier. But having exposure to that culture and what that culture can achieve, I kind of like went with the flow of the regional lean deployment leader and the site director at the time. And I have to say, it was probably one of the most successful Kaizen events, that I've ever been involved in. And if I look back at that, I've got to say that it was actually quite weak in terms of plan, do, check, act, but extremely strong in BTFA, believe, think, feel, and act. The site director was very clear about what his vision was with his people. He'd done some work with the people on the shop floor to really expose what the challenges were, what the wastes were. The people were quite open in terms of the problems that they faced on a daily basis. The frustration that they had with the operation, problems with incoming material, problems with flow, things that made the job difficult to do, made the job burdensome. And really what the site director wanted to get out of the Kaizen event was to address a lot of the frustrations that the people on the line were facing. So, in terms of having that aligned vision, in terms of aligned problems to solve, looking at how the people would be positively impacted by the change, they had all of that, in abundance. We were kind of, on the fly having to determine, 2 days out what the next steps of the event and the implementation were going to be. By Thursday evening, we'd basically designed a new layout, new material flows. We'd solved some quality problems. And the site director was inviting everybody in on Friday, Saturday and Sunday to actually physically make the changes so that by the following Monday, we'd be running to the new process. And being from a Western European culture, I struggled to understand how we could really be successful. But on reflection, that event was really all around BTFA being aligned and fixing the issues that was frustrating the team on a day-to-day basis.
That's fascinating, Anthony. So, very deep red from a PDCA perspective, but actually very, very green from a BTFA perspective. So it almost hints to me that, PDCA is maybe not cross-cultural because every culture and even within countries you get differences. And even, I guess, across companies, you get differences in the way that people behave and act from a PDCA perspective. But the BTFA is really about winning those hearts and minds over, and that's probably pan-global.
Yeah, exactly. And for me, my reflection and learning is the BTFA is much more important than the Plan, Do, Check, Act.
Yeah, absolutely. So, if we come back to you, Rob, what do you think are the most common misconceptions about change?
Yeah, time is also a big one for me, but also over the last sort of 5-10 years, there's been a lot of change in the way that businesses try to deploy change. And there's a lot of language about having this bottom up approach. The operators on the shop floor and the people in the functions, they own the processes, they use the processes on a daily basis. So we're going to empower them to make change. Go for it. Go do it. I give you the keys to the factory. Go make change. But that doesn't work, because you're almost sort of saying about the PDCA side of it, of you have the PDCA cycle. You can do some planning. You can make some you can do some change and you can check it. But what we're not doing, and what we've done a massive, we don't focus on, is the BTFA element, which is top down. We do need to provide that visioning from the leaders. We need to provide that direction of where to go and sort of inspiration of how we can get there, the motivation to get there. And that provides the feelings of confidence and competence to try and achieve the change. So I think the biggest misconception for me is, we go down this road of, we want to empower all of our employees in the business to make change and be part of it, as long as they're engaged. But if we don't provide the BTFA, if we don't support them, give them opportunities, give them the knowledge, give them the power and empowerment to actually make that change, it doesn't happen on a consistent basis. It doesn't happen on an effective basis or a sustainable basis. So we need to provide the BTFA to really not engage people. I think engagement is just one word. I think there was some learning that I did back in my previous companies about that you can't have engagement on its own. It needs to be engagement and involvement. We say that people are engaged because they turn up and they do it. They nod a few times. Yeah, we're getting people. They're engaged. They're in the room. But unless they physically get involved with actually providing some input to it, they don't get invested. And when they get invested in that change, they can actually provide more of an effective system. So that does take time. Obviously, BTFA is something that you need to work on with different individuals. BTFA is a huge subject matter, because you are touching upon the psychological side and the emotional side of people, and everybody's different. So we talk about the change curve. Everybody goes through that change curve differently. So a misconception for me is that you can, I'll come up with one vision and I'll come up and that will inspire everybody. And I'll come up with one communication plan and that will inspire everybody. But everybody's different. Everybody's looking for a slightly different why. Everybody's looking for a slightly different input. So BTFA has got to be flexible. It's got to be dynamic. It's got to be coming from top down so that we can then provide that inspiration and that visioning for the bottom up to meet in the middle. And that's where the magic happens. And that's when change can really be effective.
So that's interesting, Rob. So essentially what you're saying is, there's not a BTFA per company or per organization. It's a very much an individual thing. So I guess, I'd be interested then, Anthony, how's learning about BTFA impacted you personally? What's it meant to you individually?
Well, I think it helps me to preempt problems. It really makes me think about what human critical success factors do I really need in a transformation, in a Kaizen event, in problem solving to really be successful. And if I give you an example, if you imagine that somebody's, let's say, on a 0 hours contract and they're currently working 8 hours a day and earning enough to be able to feed the family. And then we want to get them involved in a Kaizen event that's going to take away some of the non-value on an activity, which from a PDA perspective is exactly what we'd like to do. But if that is then going to result in this individual only needing to work for 6 hours a day, and obviously suffering a significant drop in, you know, the take-home salary and potentially not being able to feed the family, then you've got something from a PDCA perspective that makes complete sense. But from a BTFA perspective, whatever it is that you're trying to solve with your problem solving, it's never going to work because we're not going to have the people bought in. We're not going to be, not have that same aligned understanding of what it is that we're trying to do and what the impact is going to be. So, yeah, you know, the people within the transformation need to be really considered. You know, what does it really mean for them? And if it means that they're going to suffer in any way and they can see that, then we know that we're going to face resistance. So for me, the realization that I've had is, you know, in order for some problem solving or a transformation to be successful, what's really important for the people that are going to be impacted? What's the impact going to be to them?
Yeah, absolutely. That's really about putting the humanity into what we do. And lean leadership should be all about humanity. Thanks for that great example, Anthony. I want to stick with that question with you, Rob. How has it impacted you personally?
So, going on to the same vein as Anthony there, I think it's made me really reconsider how I prepare for everything. And this isn't just from a business perspective. This is also from a personal perspective, having a family. It makes me prepare how, not from a PDCA perspective of, oh, we need to achieve this or I need to do that, or we're going to go on this trip. It makes me really think about the effect on the other person or the other group of people. So it really makes me think about my communication styles. I've really had to learn slightly differently about how, you know, it's not black and white. You can't just go in there and say, here's a new standard. We're going here. We're going to do this. If you don't go in there with a bit of thought process or consideration of how is that person going to take that information, you know, do you have already a connection or, you know, via networking, you know, via an understanding of how that person actually will receive this information, you can then start to challenge the way you communicate, the way you plan, and the way you deliver the message. Preparation has been my biggest change, I would say, since learning about BTFA and learning about how to connect to people differently and how to appreciate everybody differently as well. I think that's one key factor for me is over the last sort of 5 years, I've sort of studied people more. I have taken, you know, previous to that, I probably took people for granted as we're all one. We're all one number in a business. We have a clock number. But I think over the last 5-10 years, I've really started to appreciate everybody's different strengths, their different weaknesses. And then what do I need to do differently to, you know, inspire them to come along with me and do the change that I'm trying to do. So, yeah, I've learned a lot about how to connect with people more.
Great. Thank you. It's quite humbling listening to you both. And I think one of my reflections, you know, as I was growing up, as I was being brought up, one of the sayings that you hear is, you know, treat others as you would like to be treated yourself. But actually listening to you both, that's not quite right, is it? Because not everybody wants to be treated the way that we want to be treated. And it's those differences, you know, the diversity of people's thinking and the culture that really make it strong if we can harness it and understand people better. So that's really nice. Okay, so we're nearly out of time here. So I think, you know, I'm going to move to the final question, which I want you both to give me an answer on, which is about the advice you would have for someone learning about BTFA. So maybe, Anthony, you can start.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if this situation always exists, but based on my own learning around BTFA, my advice to anybody wanting to learn about this would be if you do have a problem in one of your sites or with a particular problem or an event that you're doing to solve a problem, if it's not going that well and you've raised a problem solving A3, when you start getting into your root cause analysis, try to focus less on PDCA and try and focus on the things that are contained within BTFA, because I'm almost sure that whatever problem it is that you're solving, you'll find the root cause somewhere within BTFA. It probably won't be about your methodology. It probably won't be about your tools. It will definitely be people related, you know. And as we always say in lean isn't about the tools and the systems. It's really about people. So if you're looking to learn more about BTFA, rather than studying it, rather than reading textbooks and things like that, try and bring it into a practical sense and try and learn about BTFA when you're problem solving, when things aren't going well.
Excellent. Thanks. Thanks, Anthony. Sage advice there, I think. And then Rob, what about yourself? What would your advice be?
Yeah, again, for me, it's, you know, do not always presume that people have bought into the change. Always think about different strategies. Think about who the people are that you're working with, the stakeholders. Try to think about what they're feeling, what they actually want. And maybe actually bring that up right at the start, you know, really, really at the start. You know, when we start Kaizen events and what we start them, we start with a spacer, and really to understand the safety aspect, the purpose. And that purpose portion is really, really powerful, because we're actually saying the why right at the start. So for me, if you really want to learn more about it, it's really to start to learn about the people you're working with. Really start thinking about how you can think of strategies to connect different communication styles, different ways of really connecting on emotional level, not just from a tool level. So also think about how you feel when you are being, or change is being made to you, when you feel secure, when you feel empowered, when you feel that you've got the knowledge to be able to succeed. It feels easier, it feels less stressful, and it feels ultimately fun to do. So how do you translate that? So when you're navigating change, you can provide that security, that knowledge, that confidence to those people so that they can actually feel in the same manner when they are having change put upon them.
Great, excellent. I love the advice you've both given. Thank you, really, really great. So that's the end of the podcast. Just interesting thing is that I know David Bovis, who created the Bovis cycle quite well, but we deliberately didn't invite him onto this podcast because I wanted this to be a conversation with two people who are practicing with it. We are in a future podcast going to get David onto the show so that he can share his views on BTFA, which I think will be really, really interesting. His Bovis cycle for me is revolutionary and has been that next level for me in lean leadership. But just want to say thank you very much to you, Rob, and to you, Anthony. Great to have you on the show. So thank you for your time.
You're welcome. Thanks for having us.
Excellent. And yeah, just to all of our listeners, remember, it's about changing how you lead, not who you are.